Shall I start?
All right. Okay, I will start the introduction. Okay. So today, I would like to wish you a very good afternoon and welcome to Imbiosis Webinar Lecture Series 1, 2021. I am Zeti, your moderator for today. So I hope the video has provided you with some our background. So for those who are interested to collaborate with us, you are most welcome to do so. Please feel free to browse Imbiosis website and social media for the latest updates and info. Okay, the session today marks the first Imbiosis 2021 webinar, and inshallah there are many more to come, and I hope all of you will join again in the future. Imbiosis webinar series is established to provide a knowledge and research experience sharing platform to ensure we are still connected with each other and stay motivated in our research despite this saddened pandemic. The session today will be a 45 minutes of lecture and 15 minutes for Q&A. Participants can post the questions in the chat box and I will read them during the Q&A session. So then before the seminar ends, I would like to invite all participants to switch on the camera for a photo session. So please stay tuned until the end of the session to fill in the attendance form for e-certificate and e-spell UKM credit for UKM staff. And without further ado, I would like to introduce our honourable speaker of the day, Professor Dr. Roland Merckx, where we invited him from far away from Leiden University. Allow me to share with you Professor Merckx's CV. So Dr. Roland Merckx is a professor in multi-scale mathematical biology at the Mathematical Institute and the Institute for Biology of Leiden University. Professor Merckx works on a variety of topics such as plant development, cell ECM interactions during angiogenesis, and cell-based modeling of branching growth. Professor Merckx obtained his master's degree in biology from Utrecht University, with specialization in theoretical biology and developmental biology. And he did his PhD on the computational modeling of coral growth in the group of Professor Dr. Sloot. Then Professor Merckx has conducted his research in several places around the globe, such as in Tokyo University, in Department of Physics and Biocomplexity Institute at Indiana University, Bloomington, United States, at VIB Department of Plant Systems Biology and Kent University in Belgium. He then became a young group leader at VIP in 2007. And in 2008, he moved to CWI in Amsterdam, the Dutch National Center for Mathematics and Computer Science, to set up the Central Modeling Group of the Netherlands Consortium for Systems Biology, where he received tenure in 2012. Since then, Professor Merckx was appointed as a part-time full professor at Leiden University in 2014. And from July 2018, he has moved to Leiden full-time. And Professor Merckx also was the president of the European Society for Mathematical and Theoretical Biology from 2015 to 2018. So I, on behalf of Imbiosis, feel very honored and grateful to have you here today with us. So without further ado, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. And thank you very much for the invitation. And it's really nice coming back, even if virtually. I visited your beautiful institute in 2007. It's really a pleasure to be back, even if it's virtually. So let me start sharing my screen. Let me see how this works. Yes, there we go. Oh, yeah. Can you see my screen now? The first slide?
Yes, perfect.
Can you also see my mouse pointer?
Pointer, yes.
Okay, excellent. Great. Okay, so also if you have any questions or if any things are unclear, feel free to interrupt me. So what I'm going to tell you today about is some work that we've done in the last 10 years or so. which started, or longer even, which started at Indiana University when I did my postdoc there. But first, let me introduce my research group. So indeed, my group focuses on multi-skill modeling in biology. We focus on a number of topics, as Zeti introduced to you already. So one of the topics, and that's a topic that I'm going to talk about today, is blood vessel growth. We also work on modeling microbial consortia. So there we are interested in the gut microbiota, but I can imagine also similar techniques are applicable, for example, for modeling the root rhizosphere. And also I'm interested in plant modeling, although this is an area where we are not so active recently. But this is a recent project where we look at stomatal development. So basically what drives me in all of these projects is how cells work together to form ecosystems like in the gut microbiota or living organisms like, for example, this zebrafish. And we know that eventually the shape of the final fish is determined by the DNA. And so a big question is then, how can this linear information in the DNA, how can this give rise to the three-dimensional growth and form of the organism? And what is in between, as we all know, is this process of developmental biology, where we almost get some kind of parallel processing. It's one cell that divides, DNA is copied, the cells start communicating with one another, and you get more and more cells. And they all start doing their own thing, but they also, there's also a lot of biophysics going on to guide us in the right direction. And the DNA is then nurturing all these cells in a particular direction. And so that is really what we try to understand. So how do cells work together to form living organisms? And the way that we look at that is to see morphogenesis as collective behavior, very much like collective behavior of a flock of birds. And so what I'm going to talk about today is how we can apply these ideas to understanding the growth of blood vessels. And there we see blood vessels really as a flock of cells. So really the way that I see an organism as a network of networks and so forth. And somehow we have to deal with understanding decentralized control. So in every cell, there is a gene network. This gene network can ultimately only guide the cell behavior, and it can guide the responses that it will give to signals from adjacent cells. And so then these cells communicate with each other, but this network of communication is changing as the organism develops. So as the cells are directing some kind of morphogenesis, then suddenly cells might find themselves with different neighbors. And this also means that they will get different signals. Or maybe they find themselves, they've built maybe some kind of extracellular matrix network or tissue network. And some cells will pool in that network. And so some cells at a distance may get mechanical signals from that. So there's all kinds of intricate feedback loops, multi-skill feedback loops that we have to understand them. So really, in order to analyze a multicellular organism, we should be able to analyze the interplay between self-organization and gene regulation. I see that some questions may be coming in or some remarks. I cannot read them at the moment, but if you have a question, please feel free to interrupt. So really an example of blood vessel development is, an example of such multicellular behavior is the formation of blood vessels. And this is one thing we study now in my lab. And since recently, I've been able to set up also a small experimental facility, being in the biology department. And there we are now trying to develop our models really in close interaction with experimental work. And as a starting point, we are now starting with looking at cell cultures. And so what you see here are cultures of a cell line, a human cell line, based on endothelial cells. And so if you plate out these endothelial cells in a dish filled with a gel that mimics the natural environment that these cells are living, it turns out that they are able to kind of recapitulate the formation of blood vessel networks, as you can see here. So this is now a result from our own lab, but this is a very common cell culture. But what we're trying to do now is to see if we can follow each of the individual cells, and if we can try to match our mathematical models better with these individual cells. So basically what we're trying to understand is now, what do cells need to do in order to form a network like this? So to do that, what we are going to do is build mathematical models of individual cells. And there are many ways of building a mathematical model of such a cell. And one of these ways is to represent cells as single particles, as on a grid, or we can represent those cells as single particles off a grid, or represent those as spheres. And we can set up all kinds of mathematical rules to let those cells interact with one another. At the same time, we can, but in many cases, it turns out that it's very important to also consider the shape of cells. And I will show you several examples of where this is very important. So that's why we typically choose to model cells as collections of particles, so we can also represent the shape. And mostly what most of what I will be talking about today concerns a method that we call the cellular pots model, where we represent indeed a cell as different connected points on a grid. Well, so now, once we have such a mathematical model, we can use it in some way to describe the behavior of cells. And with that, I mean things like, okay, it can walk to another cell, it can stick to another cell, maybe it can change shape, it can respond to diffusing signals, it can then relay a signal itself, and so forth. So these kind of rules, we call those together cell behavior. And then we have as output the development of a multicellular structure. So this can be the growth of blood vessels, but it can also be the growth of an organ. And so the eventual aim of doing this is to understand how cells build animals, but also how the structure that it forms then feeds back on the cell behavior. So this is the idea that I sketched before, is that the cells form a particular structure, and due to that formation of the structure, it might find itself with different cellular neighbors, and as a result start getting different signals and start expressing a different kind of cell behavior. So there's a continuous feedback between what the cells are forming and the kinds of signals we receive, and hence what they will be doing next. And this is really what we need to understand to start understanding development. So indeed, I said that the method that we're using is going to be a lattice-based method. It's called the cellular pots model. I will briefly introduce you to this without going into too much mathematical detail. And basically what we can do is describe random cell motility. We say that these cells live on a grid like this, and one cell now covers multiple grid points. And typically what we do is that we extend this model with fields, lattices of particles. Basically, we can drop in every lattice site also a concentration of signals, for example, but it can also be the strain and stresses within an extracellular matrix and so forth. So we can interact, these lattice cells interact with all kinds of external signals. So then the cells will move due to a balance between forces, reactive forces, maybe a cell neighboring cells pulling on it, and then we want that it moves. And we model that movement by copying now the domains into each other. So for example, if this red cell wants to grow, then we could change this red square into a red, this yellow square into a red square, and then the cell has grown a little and this has shrunk. Well, these are due to all kinds of forces. And so one of these could be these reactive forces, but it could also be that the cell is actively protruding in the cell. Well, we can represent all these forces mathematically, and then we can do things like this. So what you see here, the green blobs, they consist of really small blobs surrounded by a black line. And this represents cells which have a very high adhesion to one another. And then we have all kinds of red cells surrounding it. And because they adhere less to one another, they are pushed to the outside. So this is a classical problem of cell sorting. Well, now how can we apply here? You see a little of the mathematics. So this is basically how, without going into too much detail, this describes a potential energy. And we are minimizing this potential energy. We pick every time a random site, we pick a random neighbor. We try to propose a small change to the system. And then we consider the energy change that would that would occur if we accepted this copy. And then we accept. And if this is not such a bad, such a good move, maybe a cell tries to push into a cell and it's pushed back by that other cell, then we only accept it with a certain probability. And this is to introduce some random motion. All right, so now what can we do with this framework? Well, we can start modeling all kinds of, propose all kinds of rules by which cells interact and see what happens. And so if we think again about how cells can form a network of cells, so one of the hypotheses that has been proposed in 2003 is that these cells would secrete a growth factor. This is called vascular endothelial growth factor. And this growth factor would be a signal by which these cells are attracted to one another. And so now we can start taking our cell of POTS model, and we can then add a partial differential equation model. That's a model to describe the spread of these growth factors, and say that every cell is a source of this growth factor and it diffuses over space. And the cells will move to higher concentrations of this chemoattractant. Well, if we do that and we start with the distribution of cells, we would get something like this. And it's maybe what you would expect, or maybe not. But indeed, this what we get is that cells are producing an attractive factor. And in this way, they attract one another and they form blobs. And so in this way, we can see that maybe the first idea that we had about the system, that they need to attract one another, does not suffice for explaining what we see. And this is really where in mathematical modeling, I become happy. It doesn't work, and this makes me happy. Why is that? Well, it's because that then we can start thinking, what is now the difference between our modeling system and our actual system that we missed? And indeed, if we look in a bit more detail in these cell cultures, we see that in my initial model, all the cells are round. Whereas if we now look at these cell cultures, we see that the cells are elongated. And so what we then wondered is this elongated shape also important for understanding how networks are forming? And we can adjust our mathematical model and give the cells an intrinsic tendency to elongate. And then we still apply the same partial differential equation model to have an attractive force between these cells. And so this, very surprisingly, then it turns out that just making these cells elongate suffices then to let them organize into networks. And this is an example of that, an example simulation. So instead of organizing into blobs, they form networks. And remarkably, now if we count the number of branching points in this network, and we do the same in the cell culture models, we will see that in the cell culture models, the number of branching points in this system drops over time. And if we do the same in the simulation, it's remarkably similar. And this reflects the fact that we start with a very complex network, and this network is coarsening over time. You can see the same thing is happening in the cell culture. So far, so good. So you could, one thing is that, of course, one thing we should be very careful about is that maybe we are looking at some artifacts of the mathematical framework that we used. So therefore, it can be very it's a very good idea to check these assumptions with what we call the conceptual model, to try that out into different different frameworks. So here is an example where we tried out the same idea that cell shape really matters for this formation of cells in now a particle-based model. So what we have here are individual particles now elongated, and they are attracted to one another through an attractive force. And it turns out that this again suffices to form these networks. And of course, we add to that all kinds of stochastic noises to represent the stochastic motility of cells. So far so good. So you could think, well, nice, we have understood the problem. But the next thing we can do once we have built such a mathematical model is to find cases where the model doesn't hold anymore. And again, that's where we can learn new things. So that's the idea of modeling. Never stop, always continue continue finding new data that will disagree with the mathematical model. And indeed, one case where the model that I showed you so far disagrees clearly with the experiments is where it comes to the interaction with extracellular matrices. So an extracellular matrix is the network of the materials that cells produce. And in our cell culture model, it's the matrix gel. It's the gel that we put the cells on, that we put in a dish before we put the cells. That's an example of an extracellular matrix. Things are collagen and so forth. And these networks, you can see those over here in this electron micrograph. These networks, they provide mechanical support to the cells, but they are also a medium for signaling between cells. And if you think about it, it's a very interesting kind of signal, because the signal that we just talked about, it will just diffuse and the cell will pick it up and it will respond. So it's more like a telephone line. But in a signal in the ECM can be much more long-lived. So a cell can drop a signal, it can bind to these networks, and then later on a cell can come along and respond to that. So that's more a written signal. It can also be more long-range, like this video call, because a cell can pull one of these fibers, and it can then this can be then transmitted over several cell diameters, where a cell can respond to this strain produced by the cells. And so really what we should realize is that then this component is really a component that we cannot ignore. It's really key to understanding tissue morphogenesis. And so what I'm going to show you now is some exploratory studies that we did in our mathematical models to see how this extracellular matrix could help coordinate the behavior of cells during blood vessel formation, during angiogenesis. And so this is an example of that. So I'll first show you the end results. So here again, realize that all these little red blobs surrounded by a black line, these are the models of the individual cells. So this is the whole model of the whole blood vessel. We have some source of growth factor over here. This could be a tumor. Blood vessels, this is one thing we try to understand using these models, is how tumors can attract blood vessels. And what you see on the left is the buildup of this model. So we start here with only this cell model, and the cells are hidden behind a kind of wall that represents the vascular wall. And then you can see that the cells will just peek through. Now we have an attractive force at the distance, and the cells try to move towards this attractive force. Now I'm putting in the gel and the extracellular matrix. And in this case, we assume that this will just provide a barrier for the cells to migrate. So then the cells will need to break it down, this proteolysis breakdown of the matrix. And they will secrete things like MMPs, metallomatrix proteinases, that will break down the matrix. And in this way, they can start migrating, but the cells will also no longer form a continuous vessel. So for that, they need proliferation. And then we add a final thing, and this is a preference of the cells for higher concentrations of the extracellular matrix. And in this way, they will fan out a little bit. So here you can see how adding different components to the process will kind of build, make a complete model of the structure. And then we get again this final. Well, this was a very exploratory model. And so what we've next done is to see whether we can apply these concepts to for understanding an actual cell culture that we find in the lab. And indeed, this is a culture that is culture system that is proposed by a colleague of mine at the Amsterdam UMC. And what they do is to take primary cells. So far I showed you cell lines. These are primary cells which are cultured on top of fibrin. And fibrin is the material that blood clots and scabs are made of. So what you can do, you can put this gel in a cell culture dish and put a layer of endothelial cells on top of those. And what you then observe, this is a side view, is that some of these cells will start migrating into the matrix. They almost form a little tunnel and form little vascular structures. And it turns out that degradation of the matrix is very important in there. And that is done by a system that we call the plasmid system. And it also turns out that the concentration of growth factors that are embedded in this matrix, including a growth factor called TGF-beta, are very important. Well, now what we've been trying to do now is to see if we can model this whole plasmid system in detail, and if we can also model the responses of all kinds of treatments on this cell culture and see whether we could basically put all the data together. And I don't have time now to go all through the details, but this is an example then of the simulation. So here you see again our cellular plots model. These are cells on top of this fibrin matrix shown here in yellow. Then we have within every cell, we have a model of a signaling network that gives the expression of one of the important components of this plasmid system, which is the uroplasmin receptor. Then we also assume that this uroplasmin receptor, once it will trigger the breakdown of fibrin, and as it triggers the breakdown of fibrin, it will release a growth factor, one of these written signals, you could say. It will release this growth factor from the matrix. This will bind again to the cells and activate further expression of this uroplasmin receptor. And at the same time, it will also release an inhibitor. And so this turns out to be sufficient to explain why only at some places these cells are digging in, because the reason is that once we have some fluctuations and one of these cells manages to kind of move a little bit into the gel, then when it manages to release sufficient of this growth factor, then it can get this process going, because then it can start producing more uroplasmin receptor. And this is really a thing that happens by chance. Well, so far I talked about chemical roles of the extracellular matrix, but we also know that the stiffness of the ECM plays a major role into vascular patterning. And so this is an example of endothelial cells cultured on a gel. These are bovine aortic endothelial cells, and they are cultured on top of a synthetic matrix of which one can control really well the stiffness by mixing, determining the ratio between different components. It's also possible then to control really well the chemical properties of this gel. And this is done by mixing in things like collagen fragments or even small peptides called RGD peptides that will control which are the places where new adhesions between the cells and the matrix are formed. Well, it turns out that given a particular concentration of these peptides, then this is the behavior you find for different stiffnesses. So here we see a soft matrix, and we see that the endothelial cells nicely form networks as we've seen in the previous cultures. But now if we make culture cells on stiffer matrices, we see that suddenly the networks will either become really fine-grained or even they form a monolayer. So now what explains these differences? So that's one thing we are now going to investigate. And for that, we kind of forget for the moment about these chemical signals. We focus now entirely on mechanical signals to see what these kind of signals on their own can achieve. And to do that, we first take one step back. So we start, instead of looking directly for networks, we try to first explain the behavior of single cells. And it's interesting, this is a nice picture, but it's something like this. These are not endothelial cells, but cells called cardiomyocytes, but it works about the same for endothelial cells. And what we observe in these cells is that on soft matrices, they tend to be relatively small and contracted. And really stiff matrices, like glass substrates, then they tend to spread out. And on intermediate matrices, they tend to form spindle-like shapes, to elongate. And so our first question now is what is going to determine the shape of the cells? How can stiffness affect cell shape? Well, there have been several ideas about this in the literature, and one of the dominant ideas about this is the following, and that's called mechanical reciprocity. The idea is that cells pull on the substrate and generate extend some parts of the substrate. As a result, you get what we call strange stiffening, and I think you all know this phenomenon, that if you take a rubber band and you stretch it a little bit, it will just be elastic. But if you stretch it further, then at a certain moment, it won't give way. And that's, so it becomes stiffer at that point. And that's a thing we call strain stiffening. And it can be easily explained by, for example, collagen fibers that will be stretched as you stretch a material. So as this the material strain stiffens, you can imagine that, once the cell is pulling on on the matrix, then it's on a soft matrix, it will get only a little bit of resistance, but on a stiff matrix, it will get much more resistance. So it changes the forces that are developed within the connection between the cells and the substrates. Well, now there is a very remarkable thing in this mechanism of the cells, and that is that the way they adhere to the cells, to the substrate, is force dependent. And these adhesions have a remarkable property that if you apply more force, they become stronger. So they grow under force. And this is illustrated here. So once the cell starts to pull on the matrix and it feels some resistance, it reinforces its adhesions. And this we call, these are called focal adhesions. And together we call this process focal adhesion maturation or adhesion reinforcement. So now we are going to put these ideas into a mathematical model. And the first we do is that we include the role of the cellular pots model, then we include the traction forces, and we include the role of these focal adhesions. So we say that once we have a given cell, we can predict from that the forces that will be applied on the matrix. And this is something we get from an empirical model that was introduced a couple of years ago by Lemon and Romer. And there they found on so-called pillared substrates, which are ways to measure the forces that cells apply on the matrix. They found that the further apart of the cell is away from its centroid, the larger the force will be that it applies. And you can see this in these arrows. So these are the forces, they are all pointing towards the centroid. And the ones at the periphery are much bigger than the ones in the center. So now we take these forces and we feed all these forces to the focal adhesions. given the stiffness, we can now know what happened. We can now make a prediction of what happens within these one of these focal tissues. And in particular, we're interested in how the force will build up over time. Now, if on a stiff matrix, the force will build up really quickly. And as a result, the focal tissues will be reinforced really quick. But on a softer matrix or an unstrained matrix, it will take more time for the focal tissue to build up and it will become less strong. So now we feed this information that we obtained about these focal adhesions at this given moment in time. We feed that to the cell of POTS model, and now we say that it will be harder to retract a big focal adhesion from the substrate than to retract a weak focal adhesion from the substrate. And so that gives us a new cell shape, and we can again calculate the traction forces and so forth and so forth. All right. So now what will happen if we put all of that together? So that is what I'm showing you here. I have here, you see here, this very stochastic motility of the cells. I'm increasing, showing a couple of simulations where I increase the stiffness. And you will see that on soft matrices, the cells will stay relatively small. And on stiff matrices, the cells will grow much bigger. And the reason is that on soft matrices, the cells do not manage to kind of generate sufficient traction force to induce focal adhesion maturation. But on much stiffer matrices, now they're everywhere around the cell, they manage to generate sufficient force such that these focal adhesions are induced. And indeed you get these big focal adhesions. You can see them in these as these orange dots. And so once these are formed, it will be hard for the cell to retract them. So that's why it becomes much easier for the cell to grow. So that means, and you can see this quantified here on the left, this is the stiffness and this is the area that the cell will form after a given time. So now you can see that we can explain why the cell size is responding to stiffness, but we cannot yet explain how the cell shape is responding to stiffness. And so that's what we're trying to answer next. So in order to understand that, it turns out that we need to include the deformation of the extracellular matrix as well. So basically what I have the same model that I just showed. So I have my cellular POTS model, then I have the forces that are generated and also the buildup of focal adhesions in response to the cell forces. And now I feed these forces to my, to a new model that I add to this, which is a model, a finite element model to represent, to calculate the strains and stresses that are in the extracellular matrix due to these strains, due to these forces. And this kind of model is very similar to the kind of model you would use, for example, to calculate the strains and stresses in a bridge. So basically, given some boundary conditions, given these forces, it will give you the strains and stresses in the matrix. Well, now we know that a stress in the matrix is going to induce further reinforcement of these focal adhesions. And this will be due to the recruitment of stabilizing proteins and things like talin, another protein whose name I suddenly forget, but a number of proteins will be recruited to this focal adhesion, vinculin. And so that means that the more this matrix is strained, the more the focal adhesions will be reinforced. So now let's see what is going to happen. So I have here one cell that is on one of these substrates. It's wiggling about due to the stochastic nature of this model. And then suddenly the cell manages to become just a little eccentric. And that means that once it becomes a little bit elliptic, at the ends of the cell that are furthest away from the centroid, there it manages to generate larger focal adhesions. Now the planar stress is also communicating this to adjacent focal adhesions because they see that the forces that the cells are applying are generating planar stress, and so they will also be reinforced. And so this feedback, positive feedback loop, then slowly leads to the fact to this kind of these focal points where you have a lot of these focal tensions. And also at the sites, these are places where the cells are getting closer and closer to the centroid, so they won't be able to generate sufficient force and reinforce the connection with the matrix. So over time, the whole cell is elongating. And we can now see this, if we quantify this, this is a cell eccentricity. It becomes closer to one when the cell is elongated and closer to 0.5 when the cell is rounded. And we see that now for soft matrices and for stiff matrices, these cells are rounded. And for intermediate stiffnesses, these cells are ellipsoid. And now what is nice is that this mechanism also gives a side effect. It turns out that we put these cells on a gradient of stiffnesses, where we have a soft matrix over here and a stiff matrix over there, that then they slowly drift towards the stiffer part of the matrix. And somehow this movie doesn't work, which is a bit of a pity. But slowly the cell will wiggle and drift towards the stiffer part. You can see a little bit of that in the beginning of the movie. And the reason is that it drifts towards to the stiffer part is that the focal tensions on the stiffer part are just a little bit longer lived than the focal tensions on the softer part of the substrate. So this leads to a drift towards the stiffer part, and which is a phenomenon we know as durotaxis, taxis for steering and duro for stiffness. And here you can see this quantified a little bit. So these are different trajectories. We can now use this to measure the speed of these cells, and we find that the speed now depends on the steepness or on the steepness of this stiffness slope. So the stronger, the faster from left to right, the stiffness increases, the faster these cells will also move. So how am I regarding time? I have, until when do I have again? Until, is it until 10?
Yeah, you have 10 minutes, I guess.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so that gives me sufficient time to go to the multicellular level. So in order to go to the multicellular level, what we do is we are going to look at cell interactions. And this is again some experimental data from the lab of Cynthia Reinhardt King. And what they do here is plate these cells out on the matrix quite sparsely, so you can identify a place where two cells are interacting. And now what they observe is that on soft matrices, these cells touch and remain in contact. And on much stiffer matrices, they almost don't see each other anymore. And on the intermediate matrices, this is again the special case, they tend to touch and retract and touch and so forth. So now let us see if we can maybe reproduce some of this behavior in our model. And to do that, what I will do, I will switch to somewhat older work from our group, where we have simplified the dynamics of the focal tensions. So here we have included this all in a term of the Hamiltonian of the Salopod's model. So we don't have individual focal tensions here. So what you will see is now that on the soft matrix, the cells will just wave around, but not really respond to one another. On these intermediate matrices, the cells will again elongate, form dipoles, and they will also start, once cell will see the forces that are generated or the strains that are generated by the neighboring cell. And so as a result, they will start aligning with one another. So, and then finally, we go to these very stiff matrices, and then again, they don't really see each other. And so here we did a little bit of quantification again on the number of simulations. And you see that again, the cells will nicely align on these intermediate stiffnesses. So this is the fraction of these obtuse triangles. This is an indication of how they, whether they aligned well or not. All right, so now we are ready to try and put a number of cells together, right? So this is what I do here. Yes? So this is what I do here. So I put a number of cells together, and you can see a network forming. So if there are any questions, feel really free to ask and interrupt. Okay, so then we can also start with a spheroid of cells, which is also a common way to test the invasive capability of these cells, or the capability of these cells to form sprouts. And again, our model turns out to suffice for forming sprouts from a blob. Okay, so in the remaining minutes, I would like to illustrate just a few other cases where we looked at mechanobiology. So here on the left, we asked how cells can align to strain applied to the matrix. And this is a thing we know from biology. For example, in tendons, cells tend to form nice aligned structures. And also the collagen fibers are nicely aligned, and this gives the tendon really strength. So we wondered what will happen if we apply a weak external strain. How will the cells respond to that? And it turns out that, yeah, if we say they can just respond to these external strains, they don't really are able to align. But if now we give them very weak strain, but at the same time they're also pulling on the matrix, this helps them to amplify these weak strain cues, and this helps them to align really easily. So this is really the same model that we used for angiogenesis, but here it's used to model to try and explain or understand a bit more about how cells can align in response to strains. Here, this is a completely different model and also a completely different problem. So this is a model where we looked at, our collaborators looked at what happens if you strain chick embryos. So their hypothesis was that if indeed mechanical strains and forces are really so important for development, then we should also be able to apply some kind of cue. And we should see some response of those mechanical cues in the embryo. Well, and they built a very ingenious device to strain a chick embryo when it's developing and it's during the formation of the somites. And indeed, it turns out, much to a surprise, that if you strain this embryo, then the developing somites, developing segments, will split. So you could say you can create a longer chicken in this way. indeed, you see this over here. These are the somites, and under influence of strain, one of these somites is splitting into two. Well, this we tried to explain in our models, and it turns out our hypothesis now is that this is due to an induced, mechanically induced mesenchymal epithelial transition. And so indeed here you see this split into two somites in our cell hypothesis model. And here we modeled the extracellular matrix. These are these white cells. We modeled them in a little bit different way, by just connecting up different cellular pod cells with springs. Let me see, I have very little time left. Maybe I'll show you just finally this part. So this is a completely different problem, but still related, where we're interested in the formation of branching tissues. For example, a breast gland tissue, or salivary glands, kidney, lung branching, and so forth. So what you see here is a mammary epithelial tissue for mice that is plated out into shapes of particular, in particular shape. This is work by Celeste Nelson that was published 15 years ago in Science. And what she observed is that depending on the shape or the so I should say a bit more about these figures. So these are molds in which you can fit cells, and they then take a number of images of those, and they stack the images on top of one another. And what you see here in the color coding is how often is a cell at that particular position. So this blue color means that the cell is always there, and the red color means the cell is sometimes there. So this indicates that the cell is kind of sprouting and retracting over there. And it turns out that indeed, these sprouts, we found those specifically at the positively curved parts of this structure. You can see this also here in the Y shape. You see that they, especially where you have very strong curvatures, that's where the cells start branching. And they call this, or start sprouting. And they call this geometry-dependent, geometry-induced sprouting. You see the same happening in these structures, but now you also see that it's not only dependent on the curvature, but also on how close these curvatures are to another part of the structure. Because here we don't see these sprouts so well. Now, their hypothesis was that this is due to some kind of auto-inhibitory factor. So they said that these cells are secreting TGF-beta, which is a growth factor that we found encountered before in this lecture in the part on the fibrin cultures. And it turns out that if you assume that all these cells are a source of this TGF-beta and it diffuses away, that then the concentrations of that will be lowest at the positively curved surfaces, as we can see over here. So now if we assume that this is going to inhibit the formation of sprouts, then indeed we should expect that we get the lowest, the highest number of sprouts at these places where the chemoinhibitor concentration is the lowest. And we find less sprouts where the chemoinhibitor can accumulate. And just to illustrate this kind of curvature effect that we see here, it's very similar to why on top of a mountain it's cold, because then we are on a highly positively curved surface. We are away from the radiation that comes from the solar radiation that is emitted again by the stone around us. So it becomes cold. On the other hand, if we are in a valley, then we receive a lot of heat from all the stone surrounding it. So there it becomes very hot. Think of Death Valley in California. So, and this happens also in these structures. Well, so that is all what they found. What we did now is to see if we can predict consequences of this at a longer time. So we put all of this in our model. We have here our cell of POTS model. We say that we let the cell secrete sometime this TGF-beta, it diffuses away and forms an exponential gradient around the structure in this way. And then we say that the TGF-beta is inhibiting the formation of these protrusions in the model. And then indeed it turns out we can nicely replicate their results. So we see again, lots of sprouting at the positively curved parts of the surface, but also we can now let the model run for a bit longer. So this is an example again of how these curvature dependent sprouts. Now we continue this for a little while. Then it turns out that the same mechanism indeed can be responsible for the formation of branching structures. And the remarkable thing here is that we don't need growth for that. So in this case, we just have a wiggling of cells, and the cells at positively curved surfaces, they are just wiggling more than the parts of the negatively curved surfaces. So we hypothesize now that this could be kind of an underlying base mechanism in the growth of epithelial organs on which all kinds of additional regulatory mechanisms are acting. By the way, we can also do this in 3D. And I think with that, given the time, I should come to a conclusion. So I will let this movie play for a bit. And we also, the student who did this, this simulation was done by Iris Rabbers together with Andras Sabol. She also made a 3D print for me. So brother built a 3D printer and she asked him to print this this out. And it's on my desk in the office in the university. So it's really nice. So so with that, I move to the acknowledgement slide. I have some work on evolution of the of multicellularity. I will quickly show you the movie. As a little teaser, you can see this in a recent paper that we did in eLife, and we are asking here how cells can learn to cooperate in these. So not only not how they do it, but also how could it emerge? How could it evolve? And so indeed, you can see that over time, we can get, if we give the cells the task of moving to a target, they can find a way to work together. So this question about the evolution of cooperation. But for that, I will refer you to this paper. I would not like to stop without advertising some positions that I have. Some of these have already been filled in, for example, the technician, but I do still have vacancies for PhD students in both on the experimental and the mathematical side. So please check our website and the website of the University of Leiden for these vacancies or contact me directly. And the work is, of course, done by many, many people. So here you see just a few of the people who contributed to the work I showed in this lecture. So with that, I would like to thank you very much for the invitation and the opportunity to talk here. And I'd be happy to take any questions.
All right. Thank you very much for the very interesting talk. Amazing to see how mathematics can help you to understand more the biological phenomenon, right? Okay, so yes. I have one question here from the audience, but before that, is it possible for me to start the question first?
Of course. Okay.
Right. So I wonder about your all the models here that you've predicted to mathematical equations that you have obtained here. Have you validated them experimentally?
Well, that's a really good question. So far, we've mostly done that with collaborators, mm-hmm. and so we and based on experimental published data, and okay. so then, for example, we see that a particular treatment will give a particular effect. For example, we know that if you add a VGFR1 to these cell cultures, they change cell shape, and this then leads often to the blobs. There are other examples, for example, this stiffness, but we had to do it basically on literature data and on single experiments that collaborators could give to me. Yeah. But fortunately, now I have my own experimental lab.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So this is work in progress. So now we are able to make much more close cycles to model predictions and experiments.
Yeah. So meaning that you started off with using all the available data and then predict the model and then you validate in experimentally, right?
Right. So what then usually happens is that we get from the model, we get a prediction.
Yeah.
And we go down to the lab, test this prediction.
Yes. Okay. That would be great. Because I wonder, looking at your ECM slides on the stiffness of the cell just now, I am wondering how accurate is the prediction compared to the one in situ?
Right. Well, that's a good point. There are differences. So, for example, in the earlier model that I presented later, where we have a simplified model, then we find, for example, that we do not see very much this size effect. So we don't see very much that the cells become bigger on stiffer matrices. And so there, this is basically due to a model assumption that we fixed in the newer version of the model. But an important thing also is that it's quite hard for us to make accurate quantitative predictions. And the reason that we don't have the, there are so many parameters that are there, so that we don't have it would be easy to make a quantitative prediction, but then we know that it's mostly due to the fact that we would tune the parameter such that it can give this quantitative prediction. And so I think this is a real danger in this model, because then we are kind of entering in a kind of circular reasoning, right? So we see an observation and we tune the model such that it can replicate the observation. So that's why what I tend to try and do is to look for qualitative agreement. And I try to look for kind of big changes that you can make to the system such that it will really lead to qualitative change in the model, and also to an expected qualitative change in the experiment. And so what we are now doing then, this is what is illustrated in this picture, is that we look for differentials. So for example, we see that if we change stiffness in the model, then it will become easier, or there will be an optimal stiffness where the cells form vascular networks. So then we can go back to the lab and make these kind of differentials in the experimental system. And so then we want that also in the experiment, for example, we find an optimal stiffness. And so even if we cannot find exact quantitative agreement, then still finding that the model kind of that you find the same trends in the model and the experiment will be very encouraging.
Yeah.
But full validation, it's almost a philosophical point, full validation of the model will never be possible. It will only be a tool to guide our thinking.
Yeah, exactly. Because we can do as many models and as many predictions that we like, but however, it seems in the end of the day, we need to see how similar it is to the actual environment, right? So that's amazing.
Exactly. The proof is always in the experiment.
Yeah. So it is amazing to see that the prediction then goes into the validation, so it can give more insightful knowledge on the problem, right?
It will help us to see how all the components are, how they are interacting with one another. For example, how all the molecules and all the cells in the organism, how they fit together to create a working mechanism.
Yes.
And this will lead to specific hypotheses that we can test in the lab.
Exactly. Yes. Awesome. Okay. So shall we read the question from the chat box? This one here from Dr. Wan Isaac. So he said, thanks, Prof, for such insightful talk. I have two questions. Question one, has Prof done any work on modeling the growth of cancer cells and perhaps the impact of neurotaxis on such cells?
The effect of
what? Impact of neurotaxis on such cells. Okay,
So the question is about the impact of neurotaxis on cancer cells.
Yes.
And the question is whether it plays a role in real life, or whether what is the impact? So it's a really good question. I think
modeling the have you done any work on modeling the growth of cancer cells and perhaps the impact of neurotaxis on cancer cells?
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I didn't understand, but now I understand. So yes, we have done work on cancer modeling. And in particular, we've looked at tumor plasticity. So we've looked at how the tumor can change over time. And in this way, for example, become more resistant to tumors. And in particular, we've been interested there in how the blood vessel system, or specifically the kind of unstable blood vessel system in the tumor, can affect the progress of this evolution. And what we find there is that in presence, and this is also a known fact, but we could predict it again from our model, is that once tumor has a steady blood supply, then often it can still be quite advantageous for the cells to make use of anaerobic metabolism, because in this way they can grow faster, even if it gives them less energy. And in this way, they can compete away the cells near the blood vessel. And in this way, kind of hijack the whole blood supply. So a very brief and coarse summary of what we found. But I'd be happy to give the reference to this work. And I will send the reference to you. And also the role of genotoxicity. Well, this is indeed a very hot topic. It's the mechanobiology of cancer. And we haven't done a lot of work in that specifically yet. But it's very interesting, especially in relation to metastasis. And then as for the role of duotaxis in biology, I think that is still a kind of a matter of debate. So it's a phenomenon that is observed in vitro cultures, but people don't really know whether cells actually do attack, or whether it's just a kind of in vivo, or whether it's just a kind of interesting phenomena that we see. But it's still, I still think it's interesting to study.
The new possibility of doing or expanding your research, right? Yeah. Okay, so the next question, is it possible to use machine or deep learning algorithm to predict the cellular growth?
Oh, this is a very nice question. Thank you very much for this question. Yes, there are two things to that. So yes, it's possible to use these algorithms to predict cellular growth, but then the question is, do we learn anything, right? Mm-hmm. So we can use these machine learning algorithms and then maybe use them to predict, and it can be very useful maybe for the outcome of particular treatment. But basically what the machine learning algorithm does is finding the patterns in the data that are already there and really give those to us. And this can be quite useful, but my challenge is really to try and understand. And so what we are now doing, and that doesn't mean that I don't think that machine learning algorithms are very useful. I do think they're extremely powerful and extremely useful. And in particular, what we're now trying to do is to see whether we can make use of that in our simulation approaches. And in particular, when it comes to different levels and different skills in our models, you can imagine that that maybe if we want to understand the collective behavior of cells, then what happens inside of these cells is very important, but it's maybe not directly our interest at that moment. So then what we are now proposing is that we should use machine learning algorithms for some parts of these simulations to look intracellularly, for example, but use dynamic mechanisms, dynamic models for the skills that we really try to understand at that moment for that question. And so that's a way that I think that it can be a very powerful approach to combine dynamic modeling with machine learning algorithms.
Excellent. Okay, next question from Dr. Sarahani. Thank you. Thanks, Prof, for the interesting talk. I got a question here. What software is used to produce the mathematical model?
Yes, thank you very much for this question. I didn't have time to go into this. And in fact, we publish all of our codes as open source. So if you're interested in working with this, you're really welcome to go to our website and download everything, and some of the quotes are also part of the supplementary materials of the cells. There are also a number of so our codes are written in C++. They are kind of small, and so if you know about programming, then they are quite accessible, quite powerful, and you can really change easily all the details. If you're not very used to programming, there are a number of packages that can really help you quickly set up these models. And so there are two really good packages. One of them is called CompuCell 3D. We have also used this in our own work. And another one, this you can get from CompuCell3D.org. And another package is called Morpheus. It's from a group in Dresden. It's also a very powerful package.
Okay.
So I'd be happy to. And our package is called Tissue Simulation Toolkit. And you can get it also if you Google for Tissue Simulation Toolkit or look at our work. You can
download Excellent. It. Yep.
We'd be happy to assist you. Yeah.
All right. Excellent. So another question. What are the limitations of such modeling approach? Any unexpected phenomenon discovered through your models?
Ah, yeah, so indeed, what are the limitations? Well, the limitations are lots of limitations, of course, because we always have to be on the lookout whether what we are looking for is due to maybe an artifact of the mathematical approach we use, or whether it's really a new phenomenon. And so that's why it's a really good idea to test one idea or a hypothesis in different kind of mathematical frameworks, as I showed illustrated with this problem elongated cells. And then are there any unexpected phenomena? Well, yes, for example, I found a very unexpected phenomena. I found that this role of cell shape, I think that's really a thing we didn't expect. Another phenomena is that we stumbled upon is to that I didn't have time to talk into is the role of V-cadherin, how it can act as it's known that it can modulate the VEGFR2 response of VEGFR2 receptors, and we discovered in a model a really nice way of how this can this modulation of the response can really help to form, can really drive vascular genesis. And I think also the biological work that I showed, there we see how small assumptions can already give rise to very complicated dynamics that we don't expect. And I think really often the power is that we show that very complex things, they can kind of be based on simple dynamics that maybe can be nudged and fine-tuned by all the higher levels of regulation.
Okay, so the next one is, I wonder how a single cell recognizes the stiffness of surface. Is that relied on the material? And if the material is static, how the stiffness of matrix is recognized? In the modeling, are the contents of water are included?
Uh-huh. That's a really good question. We never know for sure, but the consensus at the moment, how single cells recognize the stiffness of the surface, and this is also what we put in our models, is that the cells are kind of pooling. And they try to pull and deform these surroundings, and from this pulling and surrounding this leads to forces in the focal adhesions, as changes the connection strength between those forces. So this is one, but also this is translated to intracellular signaling systems. For example, if a cell is compressed, it will deform the nucleus, and this will lead to activation of the YAP-TAS pathway, for example. So there are also all kinds of intracellular pathway, and the YAP-TAS is one example which is responsive to mechanical forces. So then the second part of the question, so if the material is static, well, I'm not sure what you exactly mean with static, but if the material is static, then fully static, then the stiffness would be infinite. And so then indeed, it would, when it tries to pull, it will feel that it feels maximum resistance. So then the buildup of focal adhesion will be maximally strong. I think indeed the stiffness always has to be recognized by deformation. And it's also how we are, even physically measuring stiffness, or even when we measure stiffness of material in everyday life. So always by deformation. So then in the modeling, are the contents of water included? I think this is a really interesting suggestion, and we haven't done it, but I think it will be very important, as it also can lead to, for example, flows. Deformation can lead to interstitial flows, which can bring along signals. And it's a thing we that I've been thinking to include for a long time, but we've never done it yet. So thanks. Thanks for this suggestion. Yeah.
So another question from Facebook. I have a question. I am not really familiar with mathematical modeling. What is your advice to explore this method or field?
That's a really nice question. Thank you. There are a couple of ways. I think the first thing is to, so maybe it's good to know that I'm a biologist by training, and I was introduced to mathematical modeling during my studies. And although I always liked computer programming very much, on high school, I wasn't the top student in mathematics. when I really saw what we need mathematics to understand biological system, then it really clicked with me. Then I was like, oh, but now, you know, and then I also started understanding the mathematics much better. And the way I did it is for me, but everybody is different. I started going to a course in my university, and but also did a lot of hands-on work. Yeah, I just tried out to write little programs and to reproduce results that I saw in papers, especially kind of small models. And this would be my advice, is to try and find a good course, but also to practice a lot and just to play around with the software that is there and the modeling, but also try to program yourself. So there are a couple of good starting points. These mathematical modeling packages or MATLAB are good starting points, but also just to learn how to code yourself. I think that would also be good advice.
Okay, so there's another question down there. Regarding the cell elongated with substrate reciprocity, the cell shape purely influenced by the physical interaction?
In this case, the cell shape is purely influenced by the physical interaction with the matrix. At least that's what we hypothesize. But there's also, of course, a biological component there, and that is the dynamics of the focal adhesions. So this is the protein complex, and this is reinforced with under the effect of force. So there's really there, especially in these focal adhesions, there's an intricate feedback between the matrix and the and what happens in the focal adhesion. Then, of course, there is the active contraction of the cell, which is done by the actin-myosin cytoskeleton. That is very dynamic. There's a lot of energy turned over in this process. There's some debate into whether the cytoskeleton then really plays an active role in this reciprocity with the matrix. Some reports say that matrix actin-myosin fibers, they are kind of also reinforced if they can sustain force, but other reports are challenging that view, and say that it's mostly in the focal adhesions.
Okay. So I think there is another one last question from me, just a very basic one. So for example, if you want to start with doing this mathematical modeling, how do we translate the biological problem that we have into a mathematical model? Is it usually from scratch, or you use existing formulas or equation? How do we know that?
Thank you very much for this question. It's a really, really good question, and I think that this is really the a skill that's really the most important thing in mathematical modeling. It's really to learn how to derive from the biological data and the observations a conceptual model, and then we can start rephrasing this into mathematical formulas. And then you see often the same kind of formulas coming back. So one thing that you often see coming back is the the fact that some signal is produced, that the signal is diffusing, that it's degrading, or you see enzyme interactions coming back a lot, like Michaelis Menten or Hill functions. So these patterns you see coming back. But the key is really in how do you phrase your mathematical your biological question in a conceptual model, and and I think there this is a skill that as biologists we develop already by formulating hypotheses, and I think what we as mathematical modelers do is translate those hypotheses that you would write in block and arrow diagrams, that we help you translate those into mathematical models. But also we then often what you see if a mathematical modeler and an experimental biologist are collaborating is that you often see that the mathematical modelers will ask questions that maybe you didn't think of before, because it's some kind of thing needed in the model building. So yeah. I think the model building is also a very instructive and important process in step in the whole process. And it's a thing that we indeed try to learn. I try to learn this in my courses to students, is to especially this conceptual reasoning. And I think it's a lot of practice and a lot of reading and seeing how this is done in papers. But also the biological intuition. I think the biological intuition that you all developed as a biologist, I think that's really the start to start modeling.
Yeah. So maybe we can have a very more close interaction with a mathematician, right? To try to understand the languages and help ask them to help how we need to transform our data, and also which kind of data that we need, right?
Right, exactly. I think that's true. And also, don't underestimate your intuition as a biologist. Because as a biologist, you have a lot of insight by looking at all these biological systems. You have a lot of insight into how things work. And there's a lot of knowledge that is not so much in the data, but it's more in your head, in your heart, right? You know how the system works, and you know what kind of interactions are there. And I think these are often more important for building a mathematical model than the pure data. Pure data will come later. Often just the knowledge that you already have that we need to formulate into mathematical equations.
Right. It's very interesting. Okay, so I think all questions have been answered, and I hope all those who ask questions are happy with the answers from Prof. Mertz. So probably if you have any more questions or interested to know more, maybe you can pop an email to Prof. Is that okay, Prof?
Yes. Absolutely. Very welcome. I'd really be happy to take any further questions. So please do send me an email.
Okay. So now we have come to the end of the webinar. So before we end the session, I would like to call upon all the participants to on their video, so that we can immortalize this the session, okay? Make it a memory for us, where we get a first glimpse, an interesting glimpse of mathematical biology. So I hope from today's session, you will intrigue more interest among the participants to understand more or to understand further on how we can use mathematics to solve our problems. Okay, so please on the video. Okay. Gallery, I guess. All right. Okay. So while we're waiting for the cameraman to shoot the photo, I would like to make an announcement. Hold on. Okay. For the participants, we from Imbiosis offer an interactive calendar. So Imbiosis has produced an interactive calendar where it is downloadable in PDF, and you can and in the calendar we have all the events carried out or organized by Imbiosis. So please feel free to contact our, yeah, so she has put up the application for Imbiosis 2021 interactive calendar. So please feel free to click to the link and they will help you to provide the PDF copy of the calendar. Okay, I will send one to Prof. Mertz later.
Oh, thank you. Thanks.
Okay. Right, so are we ready? I think we have, at first we have about 97 participants. So can we fit in all here? I'm not sure how it works. I'm happy it is a good turnout on the Friday afternoon. All right, so let me. Imelda, can you conduct the session, the photo session? She's on mute. Okay.
Okay, hello everyone. Cheese, 1, 2, 3, smile. Okay.
Okay, so I think that's all for today. So for the participant, please fill in the attendance form by scan QR code and the e-certificate will be sent out to you by the organizers. Okay, I would like to thank all of you for spending your time with us today and really hope that we have absorbed as much as possible all the interesting research findings from Prof. Mertz Lab. Okay, from Prof. Mertz. Okay, and also I would like to thank Prof. Mertz for taking this invitation and share with us your research findings. So we hope to have you back again in the future. Okay.
I look forward to that. Thank you so much.
Yes,
thanks.
Pleasure.
It was really my pleasure. It was nice meeting you all, and well, hope to see you in person. Again, yes. Someday.
All right, yeah. Hopefully after the pandemic ends, yeah.
Exactly. So, after the pandemic ends, then we can travel again.
Yeah.
So thank you so much. It was really my pleasure.
Yes, pleasure. Have a good day, Prof. And happy
have a good weekend. Day. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.
Bye. Thank you. Okay, so terima kasih. Bye. Okay. Okay, Mel. Terima kasih banyak, Mel. Mel dan Intan. Okay.